Thank you so much. So I would like you to see this particular Barrett toric printout. And if you can see here, the K1 is 44 and K2 is 44. So this is a measurement of the anterior cornea that we are doing with the auto K, like one of our doctors here asked, or with the manual K, or with the IVL Master or Pentacam or whatever you are using. So if you have a front surface which is perfectly spherical, 44-44, and you put it into the best, world's best calculator, which is a Barrett online calculator. This is free, it is online, and it will give you the value. It advises you to put a toric lens T2 power, which has a one cylinder power inside the bag. So why does the best calculator in the world ask you to put a cylindrical intraocular lens to compensate for a spherical cornea? This is because we are measuring the front surface of the cornea, and that is spherical. But most of us have a back surface which has approximately 0.5 to 1 cylinder inside the eye. So the posterior corneal astigmatism is taken into account with other factors in the Barrett's toric calculator. And for a perfectly spherical cornea, it is okay to put a toric lens. This is my eye last week. My total cylinder as per this particular machine is minus 0.25 into 100. So I have a little bit of cylinder, but in the front of my eye, I have a minus cylinder at 180 degrees, at 16 degrees. So that makes me I have a with the rule astigmatism in my cornea. But in the back of my cornea, internally, I have nearly one cylinder, ATR, against the rule. So in the front of my cornea, I have a little bit of width. Back of the cornea, I have lots of against, and my total is close to zero today. Over the next 20 to 30 years, if I'm blessed with life, like my dad, I will end up, this will become a minus, this will become an ATR, one cylinder inside. My father has got a one cylinder in the front, and I will end up having a two cylinder against the rule by the time I am 85. Today I am plano, today I have no cylinder or 0.25. It will become a two against the rule as I become older. So this is the effect of posterior corneal cylinder. If you take the back of my cornea, and this is a 3 millimeter reading, it has a plus 0.4 cylinder. If you take the 5 millimeter diameter, it's got a plus 0.3. And if you take a 7 millimeter diameter of my cornea, it's got a plus 0.2. So the posterior corneal cylinder, astigmatism, total power, whatever you call it, is not constant, it's not a fixed number, it varies from the visual axis. So the cornea is not a perfect optical system. It has different powers at different distances from the visual axis. For 95% of my patients, taking a K reading is enough, a topography, all the rest is not needed. But when a person has undergone prior refractive surgery, has had a LASIK or a PRK or RK or some refractive procedure done, or the person has got a corneal ectactic disease such as keratoconus, or the patient has got a corneal scar, or has got an unusually steep or unusually flat cornea, like less than 41, then you should think of using either a topography, like Dr. Atik said, for these rare patients, or a tomography. Why is this so? See, we assume a normal Gulstein ratio of somewhere about 0.82. So though we are measuring the front of the cornea, the machine assumes and compensates for the posterior cornea. And we believe that the power is all in the front of the cornea, but it's you had to add the front and the back. But if you do myopic LASIK, what happens is the back remains the same, but the front, instead of being curved, has now become flatter. So the Gulstein ratio is altered, and from the 0.82, it can become a 0.76 or a 0.75 or a 0.74, depending on how much flattening, how much of power you have corrected on the front of the eye. So when you alter the Gulstein ratio in any patient, then your standard calculators will not work. This is the Holliday's corneal power decision tree. If you have time, please go online and look into this. It's very interesting. For most of our patients, blink, blink, don't put any drops, blink, blink, take the K reading, And about 70 to 90, depending on your practice pattern, you will not put a toric, you can straight away do the calculation. For the remaining patients, for whom, like 10 to 30% of your patients, you can put a toric, in which case it's ideal to do a topo also. If this patient has keratoconus, has had prior refractive surgery, if he has got any other problem where the Gull-Strand ratio is altered, imaging the front of the cornea with a topo alone may not be sufficient. You will get more information if you do a tomography, that is, you image the front and the back of the cornea. So this is a basic principle. Please go home and think about it, and this will explain and tell you why 95% of torics are easy. You don't need to do topo, you don't need to have a Cirrus, you don't need to have a pentacam. Just good auto-K, just good K is more than enough for 95% of our patients. All we have to do is avoid these kind of funny eyes. Avoid these funny eyes, and just your good K is enough for you to calculate. So if you want to find out where the Gull-Strand ratio is altered, you have to have a machine that will also measure the posterior cornea, and that is only done by a machine that will give you this kind of a slit image. The front is measured, the back is measured. Both have to be measured. If you're having a printout where you're getting only the rings, then you're measuring only the front. Only when you have a machine which is measuring both, which gives a slit image, you will have both. So cornea scar, you're not really bothered about posterior corneal astigmatism. You can just measure the front of the eye with a Placido-based topography. So toric lens in special situations. So this particular person is a 80-plus-old gentleman with two cylinders. He wanted to have a toric lens, and when you're young, you kind of promise and say you will do it, and so you feel compelled to do it. This is about three or four years old video. But while during the surgery, he developed a zonular dialysis, and the back became unstable. So I am putting a Sioni's ring inside. I just put it in. To anchor the Sioni ring and to stabilize the capsular bag, I'm making a Hoffman pocket. So you put a 10-0 through this, and you anchor the Sioni ring by using a 30-gauge needle and a 10-0. I use the Arvindai Hospital 10-0 double arm suture for this. This is the older years when I didn't have access to 30-gauge. It's actually 26-gauge needle, but 30-gauge needle is much better. And then you can put a knot and you can bury it into the pocket, and then it heals well. So then you can put a nice toric lens and you can turn it around to the correct axis. So this is also one more patient, probably around 2013 or so. During the surgery, I developed a small PCR. You can see a small PCR there. So I knew enough not to come out. This is while doing IA and you're polishing the small posterior plaque, which you should not. So small PCR, you can see the tag floating about. I didn't come out with the irrigation aspiration probe. I went in through the side port with a 1 millimeter micro forceps, then tore that tearing flap into a small circle. Not so clearly seen, but here you see the small PCC. And then I decided to go ahead and put a toric lens into this patient. And that went off successfully. That's interesting. So this is a patient who I had put a suture there because he had a leaky wound and the anterior corneal power totally changed. So post-op he had 1.5 cylinder and I had targeted a -1 and he didn't have good computer vision. He was a guy who was working with computers. So 2 months after surgery, I'm dissecting the capsular bag. Here we have an Alcon toric lens inside. So when you want to re-rotate your patients, you have to get the new axis of rotation from Berthel's astigmatic fix online site. It'll tell you how much to turn. So I make one more incision and then I go in again with a dispersive viscoelastic and I inflate the capsular bag. You have to inflate at the junction of the optic and the haptic. And 2 months after surgery, 3 months, it's not that difficult, it's quite easy. As long as you do visco dissection of the bag all around, it is easy to turn the intraocular lens several months later. The ideal time to do this is 2 weeks or more later because the bag becomes sticky. If you do it in the early post-op period, the bag will not be sticky and it can again turn. So now I'm shifting it to the correct axis, and this patient stopped coming to me and complaining of a slightly blurred vision. So this is one more patient. Because of my previous experience with intra-op PCR, which has happened once or twice, PCR you don't have to be afraid of. As long as your pressure in the anterior chamber is higher than the pressure in the vitreous cavity, doing a rexis of the posterior capsule is no big deal, you can do it. So this is a, I practice about 5 or 10 of these PCCs in patients who don't need to have a PCC done. All of you can do it. And one of your options, if you have to re-rotate intraocular lenses, you do a PCC inside the eye, and then you can pop the optic into the Berger space, and it will get locked up inside. So this is a PCC, and then after the surgery, we put a toric lens. I think my time, 10 minutes are up. Are there any questions?
Time is not up. You have a couple of minutes, so you can take questions.
You wanted to tap the eye well behind the PCC?
Yes.
But the calculation which you have done will not go back?
Okay. So the intraocular lens is held not necessarily by the rexis, which can move up or down by the equator. It will not change much. If you place a lens in the sulcus, it will change. If you place the lens and iris fixated, it will change. If you place it in the anterior chamber, it will change. But as long as the both loops are inside the capsular bag, doing an optic capture, either in the anterior capsule, anterior rexis, or the posterior rexis, will just bend the rexis around. It will not change.
That's a perfect explanation. The lens will bring the posterior or the anterior rexis to its plane. The lens will not shift to the plane of the anterior or the posterior axis if you do an anterior capture or a posterior capture. So a capture of the lens either with the posterior CCC or anterior CCC will not significantly change its power.
So this explanation is true for your first 20 patients. But if you want to go really into the physics of it, it doesn't make a change at all for the low, for the myopes. For a plus 10 lens or a plus 9 lens, it doesn't matter. But suppose you have a plus 30 lens, even a 100 micron 0.1 mm or 50 micron may make a 0.25 change. But even for a high plus lens, the change will not be much. Apparently, it's about 0.25 for the very, very high powered lenses. And not at all significant for our regular plus 20 lens or less. Nice question. Thank you.
Any other questions?